Hello and welcome everybody. My name is Dara Boland and I'm Principal Consultant here at Morgan McKinley. Today's topic is why UX produces better results. I'm delighted to welcome Mr. Coleman Walsh to the webinar. Coleman is the owner and founder of UXtraining.com. He's worked with blue chip clients all around the world, including Dublin, San Francisco, New York, London, Brussels. Coleman has an excellent reputation, which is based on his expertise across the entire UX spectrum, from research to strategy, design, and testing. Coleman, you're very welcome.
Thanks very much, Dara. Why UX produces better results? What we're trying to get across to you today is that UX has become increasingly popular. Companies like Google, Amazon, Facebook, Apple invest hundreds of millions of dollars in UX. And they're doing this not just because UX can produce great products that customers love, it can do that, but also it produces better projects and better processes for the organization. So some of these benefits might actually be invisible to the end user, but they're very tangible to the business. So we're going to look at both these benefits during this session. What we're hoping is that if you can understand the benefits, you're in a better position to advocate and articulate the case for UX wherever you work. So first of all, we're going to start off with some facts about the software business. So first of all, 15% of software projects fail. That is, they fail to actually finish or produce anything out the end of the project. And if, you know, this is a subjective opinion, but if you add up the software projects that do actually finish and produce something, but what they produce is of an inferior quality, then I'd say that percentage is much higher. You're talking close on 50% based on my own experience. The most common reason for these projects to fail are as follows: that they have poorly articulated project goals, so they're not clear on what they're doing and why they're doing it. What are we building? Why are we building it? Who's it for? They have poorly defined requirements, so it's not actually clear what it is they're building. Poor communications during the project, and also political interference from stakeholders. And one of the reasons that UX has become popular is because, for various reasons, UX can mitigate and reduce the risk of these four things happening. And the outcome of projects that, you know, fall foul of these risks is that projects take too long, the solutions they produce don't work, and because the solutions don't work, they require extensive and expensive rework. And you could summarize that as follows, right? There are risks with projects with time, cost, and quality. And if you're embarking on a project, a software project, and there's between a 15 and 50% chance, right, that the project is going to run over time, there's going to be issues with the cost, and there's going to be issues with the quality, then that's a very risky business for you to be undertaking. And like I said, that is one of the reasons is why UX has become so popular, not just because it produces great experience for customers, but it reduces the risk of these three things happening. Right, reduces the risk that your projects are going to run over time, you're going to spend too much money, and you're going to produce something inferior at the end. So let's take a look at why UX actually produces better results. And the first thing we're going to talk about is that UX produces better results because it focuses on details. And in any project, no matter what type of product you're building, it's a cliche, but the devil is in the details. And in software, the devil is absolutely in the details. Getting the details right can make the difference between a product that just works, you know, but isn't pleasant to use, and a product that works but is, you know, provides a fantastic experience at the same time. I'm going to try and explain this detail focus of UX by talking about the three different types of design that go into creating high quality products. The first two types of design, if anybody ever thinks of product design, and most people probably don't, but if they ever do think of product design, they're probably thinking of one or both of these two types of design. But it's the third type of design that most companies overlook. So the first type of design that we should all be relatively familiar with is functional design. Now, functional design defines what a product is built to do. It's the engineering that determines a product's capabilities. And in the case of this car, for example, it's the horsepower, the size of the engine, the type of transmission, how fast it can go from 0 to 60. All these functional design requirements determine what sort of car this is. So you could imagine that a sports car, an SUV, and a family car, each of those types of car would have a different type of functional design underpinning it. So far, so obvious. The second type of design that we're all largely familiar with as well is aesthetic design. So how does the product look? How visually appealing is it? And what sort of visual statement is it making? And what do its aesthetics say about the product's brand and the product's personality? And again, you could imagine that the sports car, the family car, and the SUV, each of these would have a different type of aesthetic design that corresponds to the type of car that they are. So the sports car would have a sleek and stylish look. The SUV would look rugged and determined. And the family car would look safe and possibly even a little boring. So the aesthetic design corresponds to the functional design underpinning the car. Both of them are consistent and they go hand in hand. Now, it's the third type of design that a lot of organizations overlook, and this is experience design. What does it actually feel like to be sitting in this car, hands on the steering wheel, driving it down the road? How does the steering wheel actually feel? How responsive is the steering wheel? How smooth is the gear stick? How easy is it to adjust the controls on the dashboard? What sort of sounds does the car make? What sound does the engine make when it's idling in traffic, or cruising down a motorway, or overtaking another car on a country lane? What sounds does the door make when it closes, or the wipers make when they're in operation? What's it like to do mundane things like pop the petrol cap, pop the bonnet, pop the boot, strap the kids into the back seat, put the golf clubs into the trunk? All of these kind of mundane details may seem trivial, but if you actually add all these details together, they determine what it's like to use this car. They determine what it feels like to use this car. And companies like Mercedes that are serious about creating high quality products, they don't leave any of these details to chance. Right? So Mercedes doesn't say, you know what, the gear stick, that's unimportant. We'll let the guys in the factory floor take care of that. The sound of the engine, it doesn't really matter that much. We'll let the guys in the factory floor figure that out themselves. In fact, Mercedes knows that these details, all of them, create such a strong emotional reaction in their customers and in their users that none of them are left to chance. Right? And it's not that the guys in the factory floor aren't capable. It's just that these are way too important to be left so far downstream in the project. So even though I talked about this in a sequence, functional design, aesthetic design, and experience design, in companies like Mercedes, it doesn't work like that. You don't leave the experience design till the end, right? Because it's too late. So the experience design, the aesthetic design, the functional design, all of these things are worked out together at the same time, at the start of the project, before anything happens on the factory floor, before production begins. And we'll show a little video later on of how they do design at BMW that will emphasize some of these points. And there's a few points I'm trying to make when discussing experience design. So the first of all is that experience design is not styling. Right? Experience design is not aesthetics. Experience design is about how the product actually works. The second point here is that all these details, right? Taking care of these details doesn't happen by accident. It's not a case of that if we take care of the functional design and take care of the aesthetic design, then the details will take care of themselves. That does not happen. And a lot of clients and customers that we come across, they have their own development teams, they use an agency for styling, and there's a big gap in the middle. Nobody looks after these details, and the result is inferior quality products coming out the other side. So it doesn't happen by accident. Experience design is a deliberate, intentional thing. It's somebody's job, and it's a lot of people's jobs to take care of all these details inside a company like Mercedes. And in software projects, it's the UX designer's job to look after all these details. And the other thing, which we'll touch on a little bit later as well, is that the details aren't being taken care of just for the sake of it, right? The details are being taken care of because all these small little details are solving small little problems that add up to solving one large problem. So in the case of a family car, the small little details might revolve around baby seats, buggies, putting scooters into the trunk, attaching baby bikes into the trunk, roof boxes, having an interior that can handle a lot of wear and tear, having a rear power supply so you can plug in the kids' iPads, right? Having roof-mounted DVDs that they can see from the back seat, having the ability to switch off the airbags in the front seat. All these little details are relevant to families, right? You solve all these little details in a family car and presto, you have a big problem solved. And you could imagine that the problems for a sports car owner and an SUV car owner are all slightly different. So UX specifically identifies all the small details, right? Because it takes time to understand all the small problems that their customers have, right? And if you don't have somebody in your organization that's responsible for looking after all these small details, the chances are, right, your product isn't going to be as high quality as a Mercedes. And the question here, I'm sure a lot of you are asking, is so what? Right? Most people on this call, I imagine, are not in the automotive industry. But in the software business, a lot of successful companies have realized that these small details can create a competitive advantage, which is why so many of them invest hugely in user experience design. And if you look at some of the brands here, not all of them are in the software business per se, right? Some of these companies are in the news business, the music business, the travel business, the entertainment business. But they realize, right, that software is critical, right, to how they sell and distribute their products online. And they want their software to be better than their competitor's software, which is why they turn to UX. Second thing we're going to talk about, second reason why UX leads to better outcomes, is that UX is research-led. UX is a research-based discipline, and we make design decisions based on research we've done with our customers. We do research to understand what problems our customers have, and then we make software that helps them solve those problems. If you're not doing research, you're not doing UX. It's a bold but truthful statement, right? If you're not doing research, you're just guessing. You're making decisions based on assumptions, and UX basically largely has come into being to avoid that from happening. Right? Building products based on assumption is fraught with risk. So during our training course, one of the things we do is we do a little bit of research, whoever's attended the course. So I'm going to try and do this with you guys right now. So I want you to see if you can honestly answer this question. What is a web browser, right? And see if you could like describe what a web browser is in one sentence, or maybe give us a couple of examples of give yourself a couple of examples about what a web browser is. Now, it's hard to do a show of hands on a webinar like this, but typically during our training course, about 80% of people get it right, right? And they use examples such as Chrome, Firefox, and Internet Explorer. Then we ask them, another question, what is a search engine? Right? And again, about 80% of the people there can accurately describe a search engine or give us a couple of examples like Bing, Google, Yahoo. And then the next thing we do during the training course is we play this video of Google going around Times Square about 5 years ago asking the same question of the man on the street. And it's interesting to see what their answers are.
From Google, we're here at Times Square, New York, to find out what is a browser.
A website that you can search on, I think.
I call it the search engine. That's what I call it, the browser.
What is a browser?
Browser is a search engine. Browse, what?
It's where I search through, like, to find things. It's where you put your search terms, correct?
What is a browser?
Google.
What else?
browsers what you use to look at internet web pages.
What is a browser? I use the Yahoo. No, is that not a browser?
Do you know what the difference is between a search engine and a browser?
Well, not exactly. I mean, no. I don't know. I guess the internet is just where you, you know, find anything, and I guess you browse the same way. Hell, I don't know.
A browser is when you know what you're looking for, and a search engine is when you're searching for something.
I assume a browser is the way to get on, but no, I don't know much. So do you know what the difference is between Google and your browser?
No, not really.
What browser do you use?
I use Firefox.
What made you switch to Firefox?
My friend came over to my house and erased all my other browsers and installed it and said, you're using this now.
What browser do you guys use?
Google.
I have AOL. We go through broadband. The Big E with the Explorer on it. I'm not a computer guy. I might be the wrong one for this.
What browser do you guys like to use?
We use Google.
I use Google. Google predominates the market, obviously, but occasionally I like to go to Yahoo just to get into some business.
Yeah, I use Internet Explorer and Mozilla Firefox.
Oh, is that your internet browser? Help!
Have you heard of Google's browser, Chrome?
No, I haven't. No.
C-H-R-O-M-E?
No.
What is that? Chrome? No, I have not.
Have you heard of Google's Chrome browser?
No. Should I use it?
Have you heard of Google's Chrome browser?
Chrome browser? No way.
So less than 8% of people on the street know what a web browser is. Quite a big difference between the 80% of people typically who come to our training courses who know what a browser is. And just to caveat that, that recording was made in about 2011, just when Chrome was being released, which is why people didn't know what Chrome was. But still, 8%, such a huge difference between us and the man on the street. The reason the man on the street doesn't know about it is because they don't need to know about it. Right? It's easy to get confused between what's a browser and what's a search engine, and they don't know, they don't care, and it's easy for them to muddle along in life not knowing the difference. But for people that work in the software business, like most people who would attend a UX training course, they're paid to know the difference between a search engine and a browser. It's part of their job to know the difference between a search engine and a browser. Hence, the big gap between what we know and what the man on the street knows when it comes to this particular piece of technology. But beyond that, I think there's two critical lessons we can learn from this little bit of research that we've done. And they are that, one, I am not the target user for my product, and two, assumptions can be really dangerous. First of all, let's just talk about I am not the target user for my product. So a couple of years ago, I did some freelance work for a property portal in Ireland, the most popular property portal in the country. And almost religiously, every Monday morning, the guy I reported into would come down to me holding one of the apps in his hand or a laptop, looking at the desktop product and saying, Coleman, you know what? I was playing with the app over the weekend and I didn't like this feature or I didn't like that feature. And my response always, as trying to be as polite as possible, was, well, you know what? You are not the target audience for this product. Everybody else in the country possibly is and probably is the target audience, except for the 40 or 50 people that work inside the organization. Because the 40 or 50 people that work inside the organization know way too much about the business and the business model. We know way too much about the product and the technology behind the product and the decisions behind the technology behind the product and the politics behind the decisions behind the technology behind the product. Essentially, what we have is a lot of baggage in our heads. And it's virtually impossible, although I would even go so far as to say that it is actually impossible for us to see our products through the eyes of outsiders, because we are insiders that have all this baggage in our heads. And one of the best ways, right, to see the product through the eyes of your outsiders is to do research and usability testing. And I'll show you an example of that in a few minutes. So whenever you're in a project and somebody says to you, well, if I was using this product, this is what I would do. You know, if I was booking a flight, this is what I would do. Or if I was applying for a loan, this is what I would do. Whatever the nature of the product is, you know, you need to politely tell them, but that's fine, but you're not the target audience for this product, right? It's a trap that so many organizations fall into. They design the product for themselves without realizing that they know way more about the product and about technology than the man on the street does. To go back to the second lesson, assumptions are really dangerous. It would be very easy for us, right, for people who work in the software business, to make assumptions about people's technical knowledge. It would be very easy for people working in the financial services industry to make assumptions about people's knowledge about interest rates or APRs or whatever it is. Right? Because we're insiders and everybody we know is an insider. Everybody working on the project is an insider. But assumptions are dangerous. If you build a product based on assumptions, it's shaky ground. If you build a product based on the assumption that everybody knows what a web browser is and everybody knows what a search engine is and everybody can tell the difference, right? You'd be stuffed because most people don't, even though everybody in your project team might. And that is, again, one of the benefits of UX is that it's research-based, right? It allows teams to avoid designing for themselves and all the pitfalls that that brings, and it allows us to acknowledge and validate our assumptions before we go ahead and build our products. Another example of the benefits of UX and the benefits of a particular type of research comes from this anecdote about tomato ketchup, of all things. Right, so back in the 1980s, Heinz, which I'm sure you know makes tomato ketchup, did some research, did some observational research where they went out and they observed families consuming tomato ketchup around the dinner table. And they learned two things, right? First of all, they learned that kids consumed more ketchup than adults. Probably not startling, but they were able to quantify it. A four-year-old consumes up to 50% more ketchup than a 40-year-old. And the second thing they learned was that parents were reluctant to give the tomato ketchup bottle to their kids. Now, you may remember the old tomato ketchup bottles. You'd turn them upside down, bang at the bottom, and then big mess on the kitchen table. Because the product was so messy, adults were reluctant to give it to children. And this was a serious issue for Heinz. Right, their biggest consumers did not have direct access to the product, which is why they designed this bottle that you can see in the screen, the Easy Squeeze tomato ketchup bottle. Right, it dispenses ketchup in a relatively safe, relatively consistent manner. And families that use the Easy Squeeze bottle consume up to 12% more ketchup than families that use the old style bottle, which was a terrific result for Heinz and also a good result for the parents and for kids as well. But the lesson from this is that this is information and data that they would never have gathered by just talking to people and asking them questions in a survey or even asking them questions in a focus group, right? This is data that they only gathered by observing people. It's a particular type of research, observational research. It's a question that would never have cropped up in a focus group. It's a question they would never have thought to ask in a survey. It's just something they learned by watching a number of families over and over again, right? So there is huge power in observation. And observation techniques are one of the critical and the most powerful tools in the UX toolkit. I'm sure a lot of you have heard of usability testing. This is an example of a usability test we were doing in the property portal I mentioned earlier, trying to figure out the best way to allow property owners to map their properties on our iPhone app in this particular example. And there's so much you can learn by watching people use your product, and there's so much you can only learn by watching people use your product that you could never use or you could never learn by talking to them. So not alone is UX research led, right? Is that one of the reasons it brings so much benefits? But it's the type of research that's done is critical. And observation, when it comes to interactive product, observation is the name of the game when it comes to research. Third reason that UX brings benefits is it focuses on problem solving. Just going to show you this quote from Theodore Levitt, a professor in Harvard. And he says, people don't want a quarter-inch drill bit. They want a quarter-inch hole. And I love that phrase. Because what he's saying, basically, is people don't really care about your product. People only care about what the product can do for them. Right? In this case, they want to drill a hole in the wall to hang a mirror or a painting. So they don't care about the drill bit. They care about what the drill bit can do for them. So essentially, one way of looking at it is that people don't care about the features on your product. They only care about the problem that the product can solve for them. And a lot of organizations forget this, and they forget about the problems that the product is supposed to solve, and they get obsessed about the features. Let's think of another example. Right? Let's imagine that you have some dirty laundry in a basket in your bedroom. When it comes time for you to wash your clothes, I bet you don't think like this. I bet you don't think like, oh, great, I'm going to go downstairs to my Zanussi EcoClean 5000 washing machine and play with all the controls in the interface. I'm pretty sure you don't even know what brand washing machine you have in your kitchen. Right, because the washing machine is just a mere tool to help you get the job done. And you don't really care about the tool so much. All you care about is that you get some clean clothes coming out the other side. But a lot of organizations, Microsoft, for example, forget about this. Right? They forget this fact. And they focus on the features instead of focusing on the problems. And I would guarantee you that most people, when it comes to using Microsoft Word, for example, aren't thinking about the features. They're not thinking of features like kerning or digital signatures or phonetic guides or auto-summarize or macros. All they're thinking about is, I need to get this report ready. I need to get this quote done for my client. I need to get this memo sorted for my boss. Right? And all these marginal features are actually making it more difficult for people to get that job done because they create long menus, confusing menus with too many options and choices to choose from. Right, and because you're Microsoft, they're packing so many features into a small bit of software, the software becomes buggy and unreliable, and you might lose your formatting from time to time, amongst other things. And Google is eating Microsoft lunch when it comes to office productivity software. I'm sure a lot of you guys use Google Docs. And what Google has done, they've done some analysis, and they've worked out that 80% of people actually only use 20% of the features on any software product. And they've analyzed it and they've worked out what those 20% of features are when it comes to word processing. And they've created a product just with those 20%. It's a much easier, much streamlined product to use for people, and it works for most people most of the time. What they've done is they've created a successful product that is now eroding Microsoft's share of the Office productivity software. And now Microsoft is actually giving away Office tools for free, right, trying to fight back against Google. And some of the most successful startups out there, just using two as an example, have been very successful because they have had a laser-like focus on solving problems. Dropbox, the problem they're trying to solve for users is to make it incredibly easy to share files, store files, and sync files with 100% reliability. Spotify is about music, trying to make all the music in all the world accessible on all devices all the time, right? And these two organizations have become successful, not because they focused on features, but because they focused on solving these problems for users, solving genuine problems that people had with file sharing, storage, and with music. Some high-profile failures in the software industry recently would be Google Plus and Windows 8. And the reason a lot of people in the UX industry believe they were failures is because they weren't solving problems for anybody, right? Google Plus, it was founded, right? The whole ethos behind Google Plus was they wanted to create a new Facebook. They wanted to compete with Facebook. But the problem for Google is that users, their customers, didn't need a new Facebook, right? The current Facebook was doing fine. They didn't need a new Facebook, and they didn't want to go to the hassle of transferring their entire social networking life from one platform to another. And the same with Windows 8, high-profile failure, because it wasn't solving a genuine problem. There was very few people out there in the real world saying, I would love to have one operating system that worked on my smartphone and worked on my PC as well. And what happened, what, because they didn't actually focus on solving genuine problems, what they created was problems for users and for the organization themselves. Big, expensive, white elephants. The fourth reason that UX produces better outcomes is that UX helps organizations prioritize. Now, prioritization goes at the heart of design. Good design involves making choices, right? Some things are more important than others. And if you do some research, that can really help you identify what things matter to people and what things don't matter to people. Just going to show you a screenshot here from a supermarket chain in Ireland, one of the more popular indigenous supermarket chains. And this is their homepage. And I would ask you to guess, what is the organization's strategic priority when it comes to the internet? And what is their customers' number one priority when it comes to accessing the SuperValue website online? You probably guessed that it's to do with online shopping, right? But online shopping on their homepage occupies precisely 1% of the screen real estate, because the organization, and it's a great organization, had a very difficult time prioritizing what they should put at the homepage, right? Too many stakeholders competing with each other, trying to make sure that their responsibility was represented somewhere on the homepage, whether it be wine or insurance or Black Friday sales, right? And they got this mismatch between what the organization wanted, what the customer wanted, and what they actually presented to the users on screen. And I can understand why it happens, because it's a difficult thing to do. It's difficult, but it's not impossible. This is Amazon Fresh, and I would argue that Amazon Fresh is just as big, if not bigger, and just as complicated, if not more complicated, than SuperValue. And I can imagine there's plenty of stakeholders in there who would have liked to have various things on the homepage. But Amazon prioritized, right? And they decided that there was just one marketing message we want to display on our Amazon Fresh homepage and one call to action, right? And how does UX help you prioritize? Well, let's just take a look at another example, right? This image here is of the very first wireless remote control for a television set made by a company called Zenith in the United States in the 1950s. And it's got four buttons on it, right? It just has four buttons because there's a limited number of features on the device. You can do channel up, channel down, volume up, volume down. You can mute the television, and you can do something with the color hues that's related to the old-fashioned television sets that they had back then. And I would say that most people would figure out how to use this product relatively easily, given the fact that it only has four buttons. Fast forward to 2013, 2014, and this is a remote control for a DVD player. I believe it's a Panasonic. It has 43 buttons on the remote control that allow people to access the multiplicity of features that are on the device. And again, this is a little exercise that we do during our training course, and we ask people to raise their hands if they've ever had or do have a DVD player. And most people either have them now or have had them in the past. And then we ask them if they've ever used any of the features that are on this particular remote control, such as depth enhancing, or multi-remaster, or AV enhancer. And of the thousands of people that have come through our training course, you know, maybe one or two hands have ever been shown. You know, you're talking less than 1% or less than 0.1%. And the question then has to be asked, if most people don't even understand what these features are, let alone actually use them, why would an organization like Panasonic or Sony and Sharp include these features in their remote control, right? Or include these features in their DVD player? And there's a number of answers to this. First of all, it's the engineering culture that dominates both the consumer electronics industry and the software industry. And in the engineer's mindset, the more features you can pack into a product, the better the product is. It's also because a lot of organizations like Panasonic and other consumer electronics companies and a lot of software companies are technology directed, and they're not goal directed or problem solving directed. So as soon as they find or come across a new technology, right, they will include it in the product, regardless of whether the consumers actually need it, and regardless of whether it's helping the consumers solve their problem or not. So as soon as they discover depth enhancing or multi-remastering, they were, that's great, we can do a new thing. Let's put a button on the remote control for depth enhancing or multi-remaster or whatever it is. And the problem here is that all these marginal features are actually crowding out the important features, which for most people would probably revolve around play, pause, stop, rewind, fast forward, etc. During our courses, we do a little exercise and we ask people to redesign the remote controls themselves. They can take away any features they want, they can reorganize them, they can change the size, the shape, etc. And most people will end up drawing something like this. They will have removed most of the extraneous features, depth enhancing, multi-remastering, AV enhancer, and they will just focus on the ones that matter to them. And this is a form of customer research. What we are basically asking people to do is tell us, without asking them directly, tell us what matters to you. And one of the reasons organizations will persist with including features that people don't need and don't want, and not prioritizing the features that people do need and do want, is, as well as having this engineering mindset, is that they don't do any research. And one of the benefits of research is that it helps you understand not just the problems that customers have, but the features that would help customers solve those problems. Right? And what it allows you to do is have a laser-like focus, like Dropbox, like Spotify, and say, you know what, we are only going to include, or we're only going to consider features, right, that help our customers solve their problems. If we have a technology or if we have a feature that doesn't help them solve that problem, it's not being considered. Without having done the research, without having this framework for decision making, too many organizations are stuck focusing on features, right, and don't have the ability to prioritize, right, because they don't have any framework for making the hard decisions that prioritization involves. Finally, we're going to talk about how UX helps you validate your designs before you build. And I'm going to show you another video, this time from how they do design at BMW.
When we work with car design, we work with clay. We make sure that the material that we use is a material that we can work with, meaning when we have a three-dimensional surface in clay, we can add material and we can take material away, making sure that every line is exactly where we want it to be. We strive for perfection in surfacing, and we make use of the computer technology to verify that every curvature is perfect. The fascination that the designer put into his design basically comes to a point when this model is developing in clay and also crafted by hand in a clay model. Craftsmanship has a lot to do for us, and a clay model is exactly the right tool to bring perfection into our designs. BMW design has a lot to do with form developments, and for interior design especially, it's always for us extremely important to develop all the surfaces we have, all the line movements we have in the whole interior in 3D, especially in a clay model. Interior design is not only the sculptural part of it, but also how materials and how those materials are reacting with the people sitting into the car. That's the reason why the material process and design research process already starts exactly at the same time as the designer starts sketching on a piece of paper. The emotions we have on the sketch, those emotions have to come also through the material quality we have, the craftsmanship, and all the details that this interior has. We use silver foil then applied on top of the clay surface to verify how this surface then looks as if it were painted. The silver material helps us describe how a surface changes from light to shadow.
So it's not just BMW, but all automakers will create clay models of their cars before the cars enter production. So what they will do, they'll spend up to 3 months, maybe $250,000 creating a clay model, both internally and externally, just to see if they get it right. And it's only once that they have the clay model created will the executives give the green light to the project. Yes, you can proceed and go ahead and mass produce these cars, or no, that's not quite right. We won't proceed. Back to the drawing board, literally. And the reason they do this in the auto industry is because they know that cars are highly interactive, highly aesthetic products. And they want to make sure that those interactions are spot on before they go to the very expensive business of mass producing the cars. So they'll create a clay model, allow people to sit into it, play with the steering wheel, the dashboard, see how the car interacts with wind, with sunlight, and so on, before they go to the expensive business of building it. Essentially, what they're doing is creating a prototype, right, and testing it out before they go to before they mass produce it. And it's not just the auto industry. If you consider the construction industry, it's similar. Buildings are also highly visual, aesthetic, and interactive products. And what architects will do is they will create prototypes, they'll create blueprints, 3D CAD drawings, cardboard models to test out how does the product look, how does it interact with its environment, and how do people flow through the product before they go to the expensive and non-reversible business of actually constructing the building. Same in the fashion industry, highly visual, highly tactile, highly interactive products. And prototypes are produced before the products are mass produced. Now, software is also highly visual, highly tactile, highly interactive. But most of the time, if we do design in the software business, we produce artifacts like this. Requirements documents, functional specs, which are essentially spreadsheets. And it's just not possible. Not that there's anything wrong with these documents, I should emphasize, they are actually important, but on their own, they're not enough, because it's not possible to communicate visuals and interactivity through a spreadsheet, right? And if this is what you produce during your design process, and this is what you're building your product based on, then it's a very risky business, because anybody working on a project reading one of these documents could have a different idea in their head, a different interpretation of what the end goal of the product looks like. Right? And if everybody is building something slightly different, you can imagine the Frankenstein-like consequences coming out the other end. Even if you're producing visuals like this, right, a wireframe is only one-dimensional. It's static. It doesn't tell you what happens when somebody touches it and interacts with it and puts data in and gets data out. And that's why prototyping has become such a huge part of the software business. Creating a prototype allows us to do what people in those other businesses do, right? Test out the interactivity and the aesthetics of the product before we go to the expensive business of building it. And this is an example of us testing a prototype in that property portal I mentioned earlier. We were testing a particular feature, it was a mapping feature, and it would have been impossible for us to test out the effectiveness of this feature by using a spreadsheet or using a wireframe. What we had to do was create a prototype and get real people using it before we finally got this small little feature correct. And what this did was it saved us time and saved us the cost of shipping the wrong thing. And I suppose the reputational damage of shipping the wrong thing that didn't work to our customers. And it's much more expensive to change a product after it's been built and shipped than it is to change a product when you're still in design mode. So that brings us to the end of the talk. Just to recap, why does UX produce better results? Because it's detail focus, because it's research-led, because it's problem-focused, because it helps people prioritize features, and because it allows us to validate our designs and our products before we go to the expensive business of building them. If you'd like to learn more about why UX produces better results, you can visit our website, uxtraining.com, or you can ask me questions directly on Twitter at ColemanW. I'll now hand you back to Dara for some closing thoughts.
Thank you, Coleman. I really enjoyed that and certainly learned a lot. I would definitely encourage the listeners to contact Coleman at uxtraining.com. He and the team there are very approachable, always happy to talk. So if you think they may be able to help you, why not reach out for a chat? Similarly, if you think Morgan McKinley can assist you with any recruitment needs, please don't hesitate in contacting me, Dara Boland. Thank you, everyone.